Morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, with no apologies for this morning's meeting. Our first agenda item is to agree to take item 6, which is consideration of correspondence received from the Minority Ethnic Carers of People Project, MECOP, in private. Are we agreed? That's agreed. Thank you. Our second item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, the draft legal aid and advice and assistance, miscellaneous amendment, Scotland No. 2, Regulations 2023. And a welcome to the meeting, Elena Witham, MSP, Minister for Community Safety and Supporting Officials, Shona Urquhart, Legal Aid Policy Lead, Denise Swanson, Deputy Director, Civil Law and Legal Systems, and Emma Thompson, Solicitor in the Scottish Government's Legal Directorate. I refer members to paper one and invite the Minister to speak to the draft instruments.
Good morning, Convener and Members. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to the Committee about the Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland No. 2 Regulations 2023. This instrument has been brought forward to deliver changes to legal aid regulations, primarily to ensure continuing access to justice in Scotland. The instrument provides for an overall 10.25 uplift in legal aid fees, distributed via a combination of targeted fee reforms and uplifts and overall increases. The Solomon Summary criminal fee reforms have been revised to ensure that the reforms themselves, augmented by increases in specific fees, delivers an overall increase in fees payable for these cases of 10.3%. All other criminal fees not affected by fee reforms will be uplifted by 10.2%. All civil and children's fees will be uplifted by 10.2%. Restoring the criminal justice system in light of the impact of the COVID pandemic is an issue which is critical to all involved in the justice system. This instrument implements a long-standing commitment to reform both solemn and summary fees to deliver simplification and to better recognise preparatory work undertaken before a trial. They are a vital part of the Scottish Government's wider strategic reform objectives. The amendments to legal aid fees will also support Recover, Renew, Transform programme through an enhanced remuneration where it is appropriate for there to be an early resolution in cases. By supporting this early resolution, these reforms will reduce the number of cases for which trial diets are fixed, assisting with the court's recovery programme in tackling a backlog of cases due to the COVID lockdown, and providing a more timely conclusion for victims and witnesses of crime. That gives a brief overview of the regulations and their context, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. And Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for being here. You will be aware, I'm sure, of correspondence from the Law Society and their anxieties around, I suppose, the timescales of the fee review that will come, that is planned for a few years' time, and the relationship of that review with benchmarking. I was wondering if... I know you said something about the reforms in the space in answer to questions last week, but I was wondering if you could give a little bit more information about why the connection between the benchmarking and the fee review is so important, and how can we, given that, address some of the concerns of the urgency for review that the Law Society and others have asked for.
Yeah, thanks for the question, Maggie Chapman. I think it's probably helpful right at the outset if I say that my predecessor minister had supplied a letter to the Criminal Justice Committee last December, and there's really helpful annexes from that letter that I think might be helpful for us to share with this committee going forward in terms of the work that you will be undertaking to look at how we reform legal aid in the future. So from the outset, I think that might be something helpful to set out. I think if we think about Martin Evans's report back in 2018 with regards to the Independent Strategic Review of Legal Aid, he himself at that point stated that he was unable to recommend anything concrete in terms of legal aid reforms because of the complexity of the system. So I think if we think about the use of public money and if we think about the necessity to benchmark that, I think that I'm clear from my position on it that we need to gather in all the data. That's going to be very important so that we can set out concretely from the beginning what those reforms need to look like. And as I said, it is a very complex state of affairs, and I think it would be helpful if we can provide that information to the committee to help yourselves understand as we do go forward and reform. And I think that we need to make sure that we do take the time to get it right. And, there's no rushing that.
OK. I know others probably want to come in on the same point, so I'll leave it there. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Rachel Hamilton, please.
Minister, is it sustainable to hold the fees or freeze the fees until 2026, until the outcome of that benchmarking that you talk about feeds into the budget processing? Because it's something that, again, the Law Society highlighted.
Yeah, I think if we think about what we're going, you know, if the regulations today are agreed, you know, once implemented, that's going to give an £11 million increase from April, which is going to be a benefit. I think that in order to understand how we need to increase the fees going forward, we have to have that benchmarking information. We have to have that data. It might be helpful if I bring in Shona at this point, just maybe to speak a little bit more directly to the question that Rachel Hamilton has asked as well.
Yeah, I think the question about 2026 came from a meeting in the initial meeting of the new research advisory group that we're setting up. That's not a set in stone. That's just there's a lot of work that we need to do to get this benchmarking. What was shown in the review and in the payment panel was that at the moment what we're doing is simply adding a percentage onto the fees as they are now. We don't know whether the starting point of those fees was correct in the first place. It's set in what is now. What you'll see from the paper that we supplied to the Criminal Justice Committee is that it's a fairly arbitrary level. It doesn't take into account the costs of providing legal aid advice, what it costs to run an office, to have staff. We don't have any of that data. That doesn't exist from the public sector side. It doesn't take into account private client fees, things like that. So this is the data that we need to get from the profession. We've got to a point where they're willing to get on board with this and engage with it. And as I say, we've started that process. We've had meetings with the research advisory group. And we're looking at tendering for a contractor to provide the research that was recommended by the panel.
Thank you.
Yep. And Pam Buchan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, and also to your officials for joining us this morning. Just to take the question of fees just a little bit further, in the letter, which I'm sure the Minister will have seen, the Law Society says it is simply not palatable to wait this length of time for a mechanism to review fees. So on that basis, and I take the point that's been raised about the amount of information that's required to set the starting point, but my understanding was that that review was a number of years ago, and I wonder why we're still where we are now, and is the Minister in a position to say that there will be any review of the fees in the interim period, and if not, will you at least review the impact of these regulations within the next 12 months?
Yeah, I'm very happy to look at the impact of the regulations as we go forward. And I think that as Shona has set out, I don't think that this is going to be set in stone in terms of, you know, that 2026 date. I think that we're going to work as fast as we can to try and implement what we can. I think it's helpful to understand as well that, you know, as Shona Urquhart has already said, we now have the profession themselves on board with this process, and that's, you know, really important. We also had a pandemic after, you know, the Martin Evans's report was out. So whilst there has been some issues that have held us back a little bit, I think we're now in a position collectively where we're going to try and work as quickly as we can on this measure. And since I've came into post, I've had many conversations with the Law Society themselves, with the Faculty of Advocates, and setting up a working group that's going to be co-chaired by all of us to look at the future of the legal profession. And then amongst all of that, there's going to be issues around about reform, but also about diversity, how we retain people that are entering into the profession as well. So there's a jigsaw amount of things actually all have to come together. Whilst I understand some of the issues that have been raised within the letter itself, I think the letter doesn't represent the full state of play that we're at the moment, and the goodwill that has been given by everybody around the table to try and get to a situation where we have a sustainable legal aid system for all of Scotland.
Thank you. Convener, my point relates to the retention of staff. Can I move on to that next? Or do you have others who have questions on fees?
I think if it's in relation to this instrument, then just go ahead, yeah.
Okay, thank you. I thank the Minister for that answer. And I think retention, the Minister's brought this up, that's a really key point. And we've heard in the session that we held with a number of organisations looking at access to justice that the availability of legal aid solicitors is a huge problem. And I think just to get the figures right, they've said specifically there are huge inequalities in availability of solicitors. And in poor areas, in the 139 poorest areas, there are only 29, I've written, but it might have been 22, legal aid firms, either 29 or 22. I'll check in a second and come back. But nonetheless, out of 139 of our poorest areas, there are a handful in comparison of legal aid firms. So that, set against the fact that the fees don't appear to be in any way commensurate with the sort of costs that are involved, and you add to that then the fact that or solicitors working in legal aid are now moving into other areas of law because of that structure. Can I ask the Minister to set out what this instrument is going to do to change any of that? And if this instrument isn't going to do it, what will?
I think if we think about the instrument in front of us today, the instrument is actually there to do some of the reform in terms of the Section 76 fees, which is actually going to help to look at resolving cases before they get to trial where that's appropriate. Mm-hmm. There is going to be the uplift in fees across the board for the different sectors within the justice system. I think we need to look wider to think about those diversity issues, and I think that's why there's the group that's been set up to look at that in detail. I think we also have to recognise, and those figures, as quoted in the letter, are concerning. Mm. They're concerning to myself as well. But I think what we have to think about is, in some of those areas, we have really fantastic law centres that are being, supported by the Scottish Legal Aid Board and the Scottish Government as well. They're going to see a 10% increase in the funding to them too. Yesterday I announced that a lot of the organisations that are funded for access to justice projects through the Scottish Government and Scottish Legal Aid Board have had their funding agreed for this year ahead. So some of those as well are in some of those most deprived areas. So whilst there is concern there, I do have some level of comfort that I do know that the law centres do a fantastic job in those areas and that we're going to help support them as well. I think it might be helpful to bring Denise in here at this, Denise Swanson as well. Thank you.
There's a couple of points. I think if we look at Martin Evans' review again and the kind of direction that legal aid has been going, it's about connecting the advice services with the legal advice and representation services so that we get a bit of a continuum. That's one of the reasons that the Scottish Legal Aid Board manages a lot of grant funding programmes for the Scottish Government, which go to very local third sector organisations to provide advice. And those are the programmes that the Minister has confirmed continuation of funding for. So they will be partnerships between citizens advice bureaus with local authority advice providers. So it's quite a good sort of partnership approach. And then alongside that are the law centres, which provide a lot of the kind of social justice type support, advice and assistance and representation. The opportunities that the reforms provide us is to look at different fee mechanisms and payment mechanisms which aren't available to us at the moment under the current statutory framework. Work very closely with the law centres. I myself meet with the Scottish Association of Law Centres very frequently, and in fact I'm meeting with them again next week. It's a key issue that's in the forefront of ministers' minds in developing the reform programme. And I would say something about the statistics about the providers. I don't know if you're referring to the Law Society report. I'm not sure that is as representative as it might be. And I would say that some of if you look at the availability of solicitors, quite often are corralled around courts and where courts sit, which isn't necessarily terribly far away from where people are living to get those advice services. So, for instance, one area in Edinburgh was considered to be without any solicitors in their local area, but actually if you walk 15 minutes along the road to Leith Walk, then there are a plethora of solicitors. So we need to work with these with this data quite carefully, but that's not to undermine or detract from the fact that we do have an inequality of provision across Scotland. Sorry, that maybe went on a wee bit.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I think the Law Society said that it was something in the region of tens of thousands of people who were missing out on access to justice as a result. I'm not sure that being able to kind of go 15, 20 minutes down the road is really exactly what people are looking for, if I'm honest. I think the fact that people in our poorest areas are sharing a very, very small number of legal aid firms between them probably suggests, and the figures bear out in the numbers of people that aren't accessing justice, probably suggests that there is a bigger problem there. And hopefully there will be something that can be done through the reviews. I just have one further question, and it's very short. There's a number of issues around thresholds for legal aid. And there's a considered that there might be quite a bit of unmet need, as many don't qualify for it. Is the government collecting figures on that?
I think that it's definitely something that I have thought about myself in terms of the thresholds and what that means for people that are maybe not getting access to it. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely something that I'm keen to understand the figures of. I don't know exactly if those figures are...
Sorry to interrupt. We have asked the Scottish Legal Aid Board. We're working with the Scottish Legal Aid Board to try and put together a picture of where the levels of entitlement perhaps are affecting people's ability to the eligibility rates are affecting people's ability to get mm-hmm. legal aid, particularly within a cost of living crisis. So there are some things around the expenditure that we need to look at. Mm. Also very interested in the work around and some work around merits and where the merits test may well be a bit of a challenge in terms of accessing legal aid. So that's a piece of work that's ongoing, and the Legal Aid Board is collating some data for us on that.
Thank you.
That's very helpful to set out, because I think during a cost of living crisis, when we think about those thresholds and we think about people's expenditures, mm-hmm. It's a very different picture than it perhaps was a couple of years ago. So those are absolutely something that we need to be cognizant of.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. If there's no further questions or contributions, we'll then move on to agenda item 3, which is consideration of the motion for approval of the affirmative instrument. So I invite the Minister to move the motion S6M 08058.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. Do any members have any final comments? Okay, and if not, then are we all agreed? That is agreed. So I therefore invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations on the affirmative SSI that we have considered today. Is that also agreed? Okay. That concludes consideration of the affirmative instrument. I thank the Minister and your officials for attending. We'll pause briefly before moving on to the next item. Just let the Minister leave. Thank you. Okay, so we now move on to agenda item 4, which is consideration of 3 negative Scottish statutory instruments, SSI 2023-40, the first tier tribunals for Scotland's local taxation chamber, and Upper Tribunal for Scotland, Rules of Procedure, Miscellaneous Amendments, Regulations 2023, SSI 2023-53, the Marriage and Marriage Registration, Prescription of Forms, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023, and SSI 2023-55, the Marriage Between Civil Partners, Procedure for Change and Fees, Scotland Amendments Regulations 2023, and I refer members to paper 2. Do any members have any comments to make on these instruments? Okay, that being the case, there is no further business relating to those instruments. So that concludes our formal business this morning, and we now move into private to consider the remaining items on our agenda. Thank you.